Hey, what's up? Sup Cool TV, Weed Nerd. We're on the road. We're out at Weeden. We're bringing some live music today. We're gonna get Stone, Travis, the Hash Masters in the house. St. John's in the back, providing a little background music. You all know Dave. We've got some questions to ask Dave today. So enjoy the tunes, and we'll be right back to start the show off. And Travis is gonna see how fucking high he can get me. You know, last time I almost passed his album on the show when we were here. Or whatever, I was feeling really weird. But I practiced up this morning, and so I think I'm ready. So it's time for the Weed Nerd.
It's a table, it's his job.
So we're fixing to get into this right here. And the Hashman's picking out lots of nice stuff for me that I haven't seen. So here we go on this journey. Oh my gosh.
Okay, okay, so we're back live. First thing I'm gonna try is the India Rose. And the reason I'm trying it is because the last time we were going through the hashes, that's about where I started seeing shit. And I didn't really get a chance to enjoy it, so.
Like that.
See, we've been sitting over, I must admit, I'm addicted. I'm an addict. I am a wee addict. We were wee bowling, and every time you get a strike, you got to have a hash hit. I damn near had a 300 game by, I don't know, 20, 30 minutes ago. So we've been at this for a while. So I'm a little not quite with it today. I'm where he was at last time or the time before down in that other room. And here we go. I'm having cheese. It's what's for dinner, lunch, breakfast.
That's all you smoke.
Pretty much all I smoke. I tried hybrid seed stuff, and that was actually, I had a couple more hits of that, and that was really nice. And I've tried the Reckless Kelly.
Really good, really spicy. Really spicy.
I tried that Reckless Kelly that Cloud did, some of the dry off it, and I really like that.
Yeah, I'm fixing to have some of this Reckless Kelly, which was a Void 2 kind of thing.
In the same lineage.
In the same lineage. It's got some Apollo in it, it's got some purples in it.
He bought seeds and then had a male come up, took his star girl and threw her in a closet and let them together 2-3 days, whatever they do, and this is what come out of it. And he's, Cloud told me he's already made a couple of cuts for this next season.
Mm-hmm.
He also made some dry sieve. He was pretty tickled.
So we'll kind of get high and do the show at the same time, if that's okay with everybody. First off, I'd like to thank HIB49, who suggested I change the format from 1080 down to a more manageable format. You know, even on the bud shots, I don't really get that detailed enough of the bud shots. Now, when I do some macro photography on live plants, I'll probably still use HD. But for this kind of stuff, I mean, it's just a bullshit session. It's going to make our upload speeds a lot easier, so thanks to you for that. I also asked for some mod help in both the Weed Nerd channel and over at Roll It Up. And Mr. Williams Wonder and the Painted Chef, you guys have stepped it up. So if you'll email me at theweednerd@gmail.com, I'll send you a new TGA shirt. And we're going to be featuring these today. This is just one of them. It's made out of hemp. I fucking dig this shirt. It's 70% hemp, 30% organic cotton blend. So it's renewable. It's really heavy. The printing by handmade apparel is really nice. You can see, look, check this out, Dave. See how he put the black down first?
I did.
Then he put the green on top of it. And he hand mixed these colors for us, the special. Because you know, in the past, one of my complaints was apparently people are fucking colorblind and they don't know that I like bright colors.
Right.
This guy gets it. You know, he went to the website. He's like, yeah, the guy likes bright colors.
It stands out.
It stands out, so he recreated it for us. So you guys, Williams Wonder, Mr. Williams Wonder, and the Painted Chef, you guys email me. We'll get you a free shirt. Appreciate it.
I feel that. And that's 70%
hemp? 70%
hemp.
I got a special deal on them. We may not be able to get these again. I bought like 400 of them. But it is really nice. And when you wash it one time, I've been wearing the extra large, and I like the way the weight of it feels on me. I really like it a lot.
That's as soft as a newborn baby sheep's butt. Not that I'm, you know, that familiar with it or anything.
Now this one, you ain't gonna believe this. Now this is the new, we call this the Styly shirt. Now this is the Art of Cannabis shirt. And this is a 70% organic bamboo.
Bamboo?
Yeah, bamboo. It's super durable.
last for a long time. These shirts are a little more expensive. These shirts are going to be $30 on the website.
Cow,
but this is not just your same old shirt. This is something. It's really nice. I mean, feel the stretch on it.
Cool.
I mean, it's not sure. No, it's really cool. Nice. I mean, it's
bamboo.
Made really well. Bamboo. Yeah. So it's one thing I really always wanted with the clothing company was to have nice shit, not just plain old t-shirts.
Not garbage.
Yeah. Not just garbage. And so the shirts are now, I really like them and I get off on them. So we're going to continue toking out. I'm going to take a short break so we can put something in and we'll be right back getting ripped up.
Shot picker. I can do a few chords and stuff.
Well, it sounded really nice in between the two of you guys. Awesome job. Only on the Weed Nerd. We'll be right back.
Hasn't been through or wants to try again.
Oh, that's good. All right, we're back live with Weed Nerd, guys. So I enjoyed a little bit of the Reckless Kelly, which is a Void 2 like Pheno. really nice. I'm pretty high right now. But right now I'm going to try the Black Widow dry. And want to get to the very first question, and that is, Dave, why don't you tell us about, well, here's the deal, okay? So when I tell people you use it, I mean, they don't even understand the ratios at all. You know, I don't know that you go from maybe losing a little bit to almost full. So just tell them a little bit about how you use it. And
what the hell are we talking about? That's what I wanted.
You're using lemon water.
Oh, lemon water. Okay.
Lemon water. And the amounts that you use to spray on your garden to keep the,
right on.
Just tell me what you know about it.
Smoke it, Bob, or Will, or Sue, or Bert. what I do is, we discovered a lot of things, like the serenade that smells like,
feet,
north end of the southbound skunk. It's been rotting in the sun for a while. I don't know what it is. It's horrid stuff.
It's awful.
But we found out that some of the hydro people, like with pH down and stuff, and they're dumping their water in, a couple of them had mildew in there. Well, where that water hit the plants, there was no mildew.
Okay.
And I went, that's cool. Well, I don't, you know, I'm not sure what they put in pH down. However, lemon juice,
sodium hydroxide.
Okay. I use lemon juice. What it does, it drops the pH down to a enough of a acid that on the surface that the mildew spores can't colonize. And you can do the same thing. People use whole milk, 2% milk, and baking soda. I don't want to smoke rotten milk. I don't want to smoke baking soda. I'm not a, whatever they call it when they make this.
Yeah.
Lemon juice, fairly inert. You know, if a little bit of citric acid's going to hurt me, okay. However, the plants, what we decided, the plants love it.
Okay.
They go, give me more. I want sun. I want newts. Here, I'll make flowers for you. They respond very well to it. It attracts a few wasps, which is fine because if there's any bugs in there, once again, a good balanced ecosystem outside.
Yep.
You know, if we get a bug, a few caterpillars, that's kind of the, you know, the part of growing. Mm-hmm. But
and the ratios?
The ratios I usually use, I'll have to think about this a bit in the sprayer, about a 3 water to 1 lemon juice is a preventative when they're vegging, and a 2 to 1 2 water to 1 lemon juice is a good ratio if you see little spots of it here and there. And I went as far as on a couple of plants trying to save them. We ended up just cutting them down, feeding them to the cattle because they were small, you know, it was a few years ago, we had plenty. I went a 1 to 1, figuring this is going to cook the plants. Mm-hmm. Little tip burn here and there, they still responded really well to it. And that's what I do as a preventative. I go around when they're flowering, I'll try and hit all the leaves. I try not to hit the flowers, although if you go through and shake it out afterwards, that's part of using them cages. When you go through and shake them cages and the whole plant shakes.
Right.
And get the excess off.
And no, the pot does not taste like lemons.
It smells like it when you spray it.
When you spray it, it does, but by the time you finish harvesting it and everything, I mean, I smoked Dave's pot, I'm smoking against ash right now, and it's not.
It might add to the spice characteristics.
I can see it,
but
adding
it's
something.
Not a lemon distinct.
No,
flavor.
It doesn't actually give it a lemon flavor, or a funky flavor.
And we can't be sure that it's actually adding any flavor at all because there's so many other.
Outdoor pot is spicier.
Exactly.
Yeah, it just tastes spicier.
Yep.
So that's lemon water, and why Dave uses it. It's pretty simple. You know, I've always brushed over it before, but I've gotten at least a dozen questions on it. You know, and they wanted to talk about it.
So there's a lot of bored people out there.
There's a lot of bored people. Well, there you go. We'll be right back with some more entertainment, and we'll get to the news. Okay, so let's get to some more stuff. Shirts. I want to show you two more of the shirts. So this is the other hemp shirt. Just says TGA Genetics on the back, but on the front, but on the back, it's got the classic. This is the original piece of artwork that I had done. I had this on all my workout shirts. I love it. I get people come up to me and just anywhere and wherever in a store and they go, that's badass shirt, man. So we call this the classic. And then last but not least, again on the bamboo, we call this the TGA tuxedo or the science of pink shirt.
Did you show them the label?
It's got the molecule on the side. Oh yeah.
The label says do not smoke.
Yeah, do not smoke the shirt. Yeah. And it also says that it's a bamboo shirt.
There's a reason for labels, folks. Somebody tried to smoke a shirt.
So here's the deal. We'll get this website launched here quickly. I'm going to do a little special. I'm going to sell one of these jars and one of the hemp shirts and for $40.
So if you guys can't wait till the website gets up, you guys can email theweednerd@gmail.com, and you can PayPal it. So anyway, here's the deal on that. Space Dog is ready. So that's the famed Snow Dog times Space Queen. And it's ready, so it should be available pretty soon. News. Arizona Judge Richard Gamma struck down the restrictions that state officials had planned to use to determine which applicants were eligible. Judge Gamma noted that Arizona voters wanted the Medical Marijuana Act implemented 120 days after it was passed, and that has not been done. Basically, this judge in Arizona said, get off of it already and open up the goddamn dispensaries. They've caused a mess down there. It's Governor Jan Brewer by filing a petition with the federal government, which was also struck down. So it looks like things are going to be moving ahead in Arizona. Campaign to legalize marijuana kicking off in Michigan. Michigan led the way in ending failed experiment known as alcohol prohibition. I don't know if you guys know that. And very likewise intend to put an end to the wasted resources, screwed political priorities, and very real collateral damage of marijuana prohibition. So you Michigan voters, I hope the hell you do. I've always said that legal marijuana will be actually decriminalized or legalized in one of the states before medical marijuana moved forward federally. Ohio's second medical marijuana ballot issue was certified. Ohio's second proposed medical marijuana ballot issue took a step forward Friday when it was certified by Attorney General Mike DeWine. So that's more good news in Ohio. It looks like maybe medical marijuana is going to get on the ballot there too. So yeah,
that's
so we
pretty important state.
That's a pretty important state, you know. Yeah, so it's kind of pivotal. So it looks like a lot of good news went on. The bad news is, you know, the raids went on in San Diego. We talked about on one of the shows. Some raids have happened in Colorado as well. The feds just won't continue to are going to continue to waste our resources. So yeah, I don't understand why. So we've got some questions now, and we'll just go ahead and get to them. People want to know if we're going to be attending the High Times Cannabis Cup in California this year, and I don't think we are. I'm really busy working on the clothing project and book three and just a lot of other things. And as much as I like going down to the cup, it's a big distraction if you run a business. And so Miss Jill wants me to go at least one of them because it's sunny and we can just go walk around and everything. But I doubt we take the traveling circus on the road. If they have it in Seattle, we will.
The sun's out here.
The sun's out here, I know. It's nice here.
34.
Yeah. It's fucking freezing.
Wind's blowing.
If they have a cannabis cup in Seattle, we'll go. Because I love Seattle. I think it's a fucking cool-ass city. You know?
Quick trip.
It's great. It's a quick trip, and it's a great... It's just an awesome city. I mean, the nightlife... As long as it's not fucking raining. The nightlife in Seattle is kicking.
Seattle rain?
The hotels are really nice, you know, and it... but we are going to go to HempFest this year. We're going to be major sponsors. And I haven't heard back from Vivian McBeat yet, but hopefully I will soon. And we would just want to make sure we get it going and have a good time out there, have lots of booth space. Because HempFest is a great party, especially if the weather's nice. So we invite all of you to come up. And we're going to have books and posters and all the t-shirts and all that good stuff will be there. So we invite you to come on up. Let's see, power outages and their effect on indoor gardens. Well, they're pretty fucking bad, I'll tell you. More than a couple of days, and you can cause some serious stress to your gardens. When this has happened to me, I always run out and get a little 3K generator, and you know, basically just plug in at least one light to keep the photo cycle going.
Anything you get could be a bonus, and figure on you're going to start over again.
Exactly. But you can't leave your plants in the dark. Now, this person specifically asked about, you know, resetting. And I will say this, you know, when something happens to my garden, like, I've had timers burn up and have weird stuff happen too for short periods of time. But basically, if I'm in flower, the only thing I'm worried about is that no matter what has happened, we enter a 12-hour dark period right away.
Yeah.
You don't want in a 12-hour dark period.
You don't want to up the dark.
Yeah, you don't want to up the dark. That's what you say. So when you reset, you want to light reset too. Now, in veg, I really don't think it's as crucial because I used to have the issue of I had plants in one room that were running at night and I moved them into the next room and, you know, I didn't see no shock. I mean, I think while you can shock plants with light, it's not instantaneous. You know, I don't think opening a door and letting a little light in a room is as bad as a tiny leak of light into a room.
Well, some people say, you know, a pinhole leak and it hurt me my whole thing, or everything got mites all of a sudden because I had a pinhole. No, you got a pinhole light and something happened in your room, you got bigger problems.
You got bigger problems, yeah. But it is something that we see in indoors, that people don't light-proof their rooms well enough.
Yeah.
Because air conditioners, today's air conditioners are shitty. It's been got like a half inch piece of fucking styrofoam in there separating the condenser from the evaporator. So, you know, the one thing I do tell people about that is go into your dark room. Now, Dave's right, you get a pretty good bit of slack. This is the way we've always said as old school growers, it has to be more light than a full moon, you know? I mean, so you get a good bit of variance, but yeah, if you've run it at night and you've got an air conditioner and the sun shining on it, say from 12 to 3, I had this problem. I had to take the air conditioner apart, paint the fucking thing black.
You know? Paint it black.
Yeah, you know, and flash it. So yeah, that's something you guys do need to be aware of. But you know, basically all I can tell you is with these shortages and with these outages for power, it's a real pain in the ass. And imagine this, I used to run like 12 ebb and flow tables, so when the power went off, fucking, you're screwed, man. You're running around there with buckets, yeah, you got it. I was, you know, keep these fucking things alive.
Yep.
So to sum up on that, you know, get a generator, get some temporary lighting in there to keep your photo cycle normal, whether you're in 12-12 or 18-6, you don't necessarily have to light that whole crop up. But put enough light in there, you know, maybe you could even get some compact fluorescence in there to keep your cycles correct. Digital ballast, you guys are going to believe this, you and you. So basically, I needed a new ballast last week, and so I went and bought a 400 watt ballast, and I bought a digital, a Lumitech. I talked to my friends, you know, I'm plugged into the industry, and when Lumitech first came out, they had lots of problems. They fucked up things and messed up telephones. Oh my God, there was all kind of crazy stuff going on. But from my understanding of people that buy hundreds of these things, that they worked out now and they're fixed. All up to about a year ago, they would burn your bulbs out faster than a normal light. They had this issue. And again, my friends in the know, you know, that buy a lot and sell a lot of these things, tell me they've got this issue worked out as well. So these things don't burn out bulbs as long as you have nice bulbs.
Right.
So so I put this 400 on. I want you to know this motherfucker is bright, son. I had to raise my bulbs. I actually scorched my plants a little bit. So
that brand new bulb.
With a 400, brand new blue Hortolux. So I decided to take the plunge. I have a one of these old black 1,000 watt ballasts that's known to catch on fire, and Doc so I would give a shit about it.
Yep.
So I went down there and got a new 1,000 watt light, and I put it on that Hortolux blue 1000, the blue spectrum, and that thing is always burned with a nice normal cap and ballast trans ballast, cap and transfer ballast, kind of a green blue. It had this kind of eerie blue glow to it. You can, you know, you guys are familiar with my work, you can see it in my videos, that green. Man, we plugged that 1000 watt Lumitech into that son of a bitch, and I want you to know that's like a fucking convection oven, dude. That green and blue went away, and I mean that fucker is right. So I actually did take the plunge, and I've replaced all of my ballasts now with digitals this week. Everywhere. I put them. I've replaced all of my ballasts, and I want you to know the same thing happened in my flower.
Poof. Right.
Oh my God! Now,
did your plants respond like, yeah, we want a flower, or we want to re-veg a little?
No. I tell you what they did in the veg room. What I noticed was just after 3 days with those lights on, the tips of my growth had turned a lighter green. And was going for the one, man. Just ha, you know. And I'd already replaced the bulbs, so I actually saw a difference with the digital bulbs. So
and the
digital bulbs, yeah. Regardless of what I have said in the past, because I'm old school and I've always said I'm not buying digital bulbs. You know, there's no need.
They'll get them right one of these days.
I then also said that I didn't really see a huge benefit, but I can tell you that I turned off 2400 watts with standard ballast and replaced all the ballast and turned it back on, and there's no doubt about it that it is much, much, much more intense. And there is absolutely no doubt that a 400, a good 16 inches away, was cooking clones and seedlings. So that's how bright the daggone thing is. So I'll have to say that I am surprised by the results and happy. Although if I was a starting out grower, I couldn't have done that.
you know, I mean, this was a $2,000 purchase. I bought four 1,000 ballasts and two 400s.
They're not cheap.
They're not cheap, but they are really nice, and I have knocked them down in the past. I didn't really knock them down. I just said I didn't see the need for
them. They were still growing.
They were still growing.
They were knocking bulbs out right, left, and side.
And they were smoking bulbs. They were, smoking bulbs.
It'll be interesting to see how your bulb life is affected by the greater output.
Dioxide has already told me that he hasn't noticed a diminished effect, but now he runs, I think he's a six-monther. And I've always been a one-year guy, and I just harvested off my last 1 year, and I might follow. It took us, bean counter, I had four, and I had seven, so it took us 11 hours to trim the plant, so I mean, that's not a small plant, you know, so, and that was under one-year-old bulbs. So, you know, that's always such a subjective thing, especially with me, since I don't weigh. I mean, I'm not, you know, back there,
counting grams.
I go, hey, I got seven jars. Hey, I got eight jars.
That's about as much.
It's an ounce. I figure a jar is an ounce, except for the Urkels and the Quirkels and that kind of stuff. So, but yeah, you know, I think that they were okay, but I am looking forward to, I have a whole batch ready. And my patient's just renewed, so we're ready to rock and roll. And I'm gonna load them all in there, and they're all that bright light. And I just replaced my foil on, which is also something that I suggest you do if you have foil on that's 3 years old. You know, it's still bright. I just staple right over the top of it. And wow.
It's little efficiencies.
It's little, you know, and it's hard to go in my grow room right now.
Well, doing that, when you take and put new anything reflective over an old surface, just make sure you keep your room clean, because that's like a
mold and mildew can grow underneath
mold,
it really
mildew,
bad.
Bugs, bugs and yeah. In there.
That's really good. You
know, I've seen horror stories from that.
It's really good. So, cannabis books to read. Some one of my fans wanted to know what cannabis books to read. And, you know, Clark's Botany is still really the definitive guide to breeding. Although, if you go online, you can certainly find articles written by me which simplify the breeding process as far as the mechanics of it. You know, instead of this capital A, capital B stuff in my breeding one and breeding two article, I actually use names of plants, so it's a little bit easier. So, and the other one is Ed's new grow book is, I started to bring a copy and I forgot to bring it with me. Ed's revised grow book has information on every fucking aspect of growing you could possibly want to know. I mean, it really is, it blew me away. I mean, I'm not, you know, one to say that one book can discuss every method on marijuana, but my God, it covers LED lighting, it covers hydroponics, it covers organics, it covers harvesting, it covers hash making, it covers cooking, and certainly not, you know, every way to do something. There's always more than one way to skin a cat, as there were, but, you know, if you read this book cover to cover, you would certainly understand not only the how to grow the plant, but the industry very well, because, you know, it's got information on all the equipment that you use, including digital ballast. I mean, fuck, it actually talks about, you know, T5s, digital ballast.
Up to date.
Not
really old school.
Yeah, and so, yeah, those two books right there, but, you know, I've said it so many times, I've caught flack over it, but, you know, right now, the internet, I mean, I can find out anything with my phone. Fuck, my iPhone will tell me where to bury a body if I ask it. I mean, no, it asks you if you want a crematorium, a dump, a morgue, the cops. I mean, it's pretty crazy, you know. But,
recycling yard.
But yeah, but you know, there's so much information out there, especially now that we have the YouTube. That you know, I'm going to suggest now that you YouTube it, because you know, I have 253 videos now, and I'm just one of hundreds of people that are out there doing this. So. I've had my plants under 24 hours for over a year on some cuts and about 60 days at this point. My newer seedlings is, my question is, will they go flower if I go to 18.6? No. And so I actually wanted to talk about, I don't think they will.
Cannabis plants are phototropic. Yeah. There we go. You have to get, in general, there are some auto flower and ones that aren't really desirable as far as I'm concerned. 13 3/4 hours light will trigger.
Right.
And I've seen people run, you know, 13 and a half, 11 and a half.
People like to play games with lights to try to get the max light.
Yeah.
And I can't say whether that's good or bad. I've just never wanted to be that experimental.
Yeah. When we were still growing indoors, I just, you know, good to all you folks that can afford to grow indoors and stuff. We just don't need to anymore. Right. We do one crop and we're done and we can enjoy the monsoon season. Just like nature, you know, it starts as soon as mid-September comes around, mid-August, the light's getting down to 13¾ ambient hours. Pow, they trigger, and by the time we're done this year, we were down below 12-12.
Now, that's different than the problem that you have, or all outdoor growers have, of if I give you a clone that's an 18-6, and it goes outside, and it gets too close to that trigger,
they'll trigger.
While it's still in the spring, even. You bet. Doesn't matter, it'll trigger. And that's why you try to match the outdoor cycle
as close as we can. Right. We don't throw anything out till about May 21st.
Okay.
Where we're at as compared to the equator and the North Pole, because they'll trigger. This year, some had to go outside.
We had a crappy season this year.
And it'd roll in and stay gray for 6-8 hours a day and then light a little bit, and they all wanted to flower. However, the re-veg and stuff on some of them, they weren't as big as they usually are, but we had plenty, you know.
Yeah, no, it was pretty, but... Yeah.
And they did just fine. You know, you seen them.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But that is something that I learned about the whole, you know, basically... And when it's still plenty warm here, and you would think, oh my God, I can carry a plant outside. You can't necessarily. You got to wait until the light is long.
Yeah, you got to harden it off.
Yeah.
It's part of the hardening process.
Well, then that's the other thing that you've got to be good at, because I've actually stuck a couple of plants outdoors, and I've grown a couple of plants outdoors, but you got to be careful. That sunshine is brutal.
Yeah.
It'll fuck a plant up.
You can kill clones in an hour if you let them just see some diffuse sunlight.
It's crazy. I thought just some shade would do it, but the light came in from the side at 4:30 and it fried them.
Light travels through leaves, so even if you think you're in the shade, they're still getting...
Yeah, so hardening is kind of an art that you have to learn where in your garden to put them to get them out.
What we do is we harden them off for at least a week in mottled sunshine at the very best, usually on the north side of something.
Okay.
And then another 3, 4, 5, 7 days in the mottled, like under a tree with leaves, that kind of stuff. And then you can wean them out in the full sun, because the full sun will cook plants real quick if they're not used to it.
Yep. So I've got a couple more questions, but let's take a break and then you do another song for us?
You bet.
All right, we'll be right back. Weed Nerd, Subcool TV. We're back with Dave, St. John in the background. Travis, Hash Master, sitting there in the corner feeding me amazing hash right now. We've got some Vortex. Smells like fucking Gerber peaches or some shit, man. It's pretty right.
I can smell from here.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. So, Dave's going to play us something here a little bit, but I wanted to go over this. Somebody wanted to know, actually, he was quite rude, and I got rid of most of his comments, but he wanted to know why I use Space Queen over and over in my crosses. And, well, number one, we have quite several males. We have Vortex male, and we have a Coracle male. We have other males we're looking at. The Space Dude is proven, and that's why we use it so much.
So don't you use Space Dude?
Yeah, Space Dude. I mean, yeah. He's you know, everything I've ever crossed him with has been a hit. And so we know when we get something new that when we outcross it, if we want to kind of see what it's going to do, mm-hmm. how it's going to look, mm-hmm. we know that we can take something and cross it by the Space Queen. Well, we know what traits he lands because we've crossed him out 100 times.
Right.
And, you know, you get winners or losers right out of the gate with him. And it really tells us a lot about the breeding genetics of the mom, because we really don't know a lot. People want to conjecture where it came from, whether it's the real one or whatever. So just like with Bubba Kush, you know, the reason we crossed the pre-98 that we supposedly have the pre-98, what we know is we fucking like it.
Right.
We know that when we smoke it, we enjoy it. We know that when I was sick in Maui, man, it saved my life, to be honest with you.
Well, I've had that's a real McCoy.
It's
the same one that I had in the garden.
Right.
I've seen it since.
Yeah, it's a nice strain. It was a nice 70s,
mid-late 90s.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
so, but I don't get hung up into is it.
Right.
I get hung up into I like this a lot and it's unusual. And then we make the new cross, the Kush, and we find out whether we get good results or not. And from there we will determine whether that Bubba Kush
clone is worthy of continuing to work with? Is she worthy of outcrossing? Is she worthy of working out? If she's a genetic mess with Space Queen, then we probably wouldn't want to be working with her. This happened, for instance, with the Black Dahlia. This is a strain that people ask me about. They want me to release it. We made it. We crossed it. And we had test growers grow it out. The results were way too varied. There was way too much dual sex hermaphrodite mess going on. People also found juicy purple berry ones, and so everybody urged me to keep it around, and I was just like, no, I got all these bad results, and so we just scrapped it. And it's funny, it's in the clubs down south because, you know, we gave out hundreds of test seeds, you know, so somebody obviously found a clone they like, and they're selling the meds to a dispensary somewhere, and then more power to them. But that's the kind of thing that goes on with breeding. So that's why we use Space Queen so much. So what you gonna hit us with? Why?
I think we do a love song. Okay. Mr. Jason Boland wrote.
Okay.
My baby loves me when I'm stoned, as I find my way home. Well, my baby, she don't care about song I sing or clothes I wear. Lots of late night calls on telephone. My baby loves me when I'm stoned. Makes me see the picture. She makes me see red. She puts me on a pedestal and messes with my head. Don't want me in no office. Ain't no three-piece suit.
Dave needs some water and we had a hash. So that's what we're up to now. So one of the things that I saved for the end to talk about that we've talked about on the show before, but we'll talk about again because people seem to want to hear about it. And that's Fem Seeds, but today a little bit different take on it. Want to talk about, especially with you know, Fem Seeds and their ramifications when it comes to natural outdoor growing and you know, the release of pollen or something like that outdoors, you know? Can you imagine the mess that could cause?
I've had a few people that, here, you got to try this. Everybody wants to give me a cut or a clone or something. You've got to try this in your garden. Please try this in your garden. And I've tried a few of them and had horrid results from nanners.
Right, right.
Chucking pollen. And no offense to anybody that does seeds or whatever, to me they're a scourge because I can get cuts, you know, I can get clones, I can get anything. And well, with it's also weight. It adds weight to what we can hang on to.
Right, right, right.
You know, and you probably know what a pain in the ass is to pop seeds. That's why I got rid of my Frisbee and my Monopoly board and crap from cleaning seeds out. Not a fan of them.
Right,
that's
right.
Where I'm going with
this. Yeah, yeah. And so, you know, so that's and I knew that's what he'd say. But on the other end of it, I mean, you know, if you have people that work with these genetics and get a clone of it, and then if they were to breed with it, I mean, they're breeding in a mess is basically what I'm trying to say. So
There's other ramifications than just what they would do directly in a garden if they don't perform properly. And that's the long-term bottlenecking of the strains. Because, you know, we're always going back trying to get as close to the original clone as possible to the, you know, I look at it like kind of a Eureka goal moment. You know, when someone finds a cutting.
The pheno.
That pheno. You know, that's the stuff. I don't think I've told the story as a weed nerd, but I'll tell you guys. When we first met Sly and Soul, he sent Pi a camera case. And the camera case had some P75 in it and about 50 of the original Cindy 99 seeds. And that bud was so fucking good. I mean, it was like smoking pears and candy with a little bit of kind of a oily perfume essence. But here's the coolest thing. That film canister was so fucking badass. I mean, after it was empty, It smelled so good. You could put regular pot in
there. Make it better.
It would transform into this nice smelling pot for like a month. You know, we were smoking, at the time when we weren't smoking that, the commercial weed for sale at the time was kind of, the good commercial weed at the time, was something that was green and it had been compacted and it had kind of a soap smell to it. I always thought it must have been brought in and
so good.
It was so bad.
So good.
And it was okay. I mean, it wasn't shitty. It wasn't brick weed. But it was fucking expensive. It was $300 an ounce. And it was green and it was pretty and it didn't have seeds in it, you know. And that was considered basically the kind bud where I was from. Now, you guys are from the West Coast, so life's kind of a different story, but you've traveled, so you've seen soap bud before.
Oh, I've seen soap bud. I remember that crap.
So, you know, we could even put soap bud in this fucking camera case and carry it around for about 6 hours, and then when you smell, well, at least when you smelled it, it fucking smelled good. Yeah, you know. So I was like, that was the first time I encountered it. So my point is, that was a specific phenotype, that P75. And that's nothing more than all the strains that we go through. When I find the strains for you this spring, the Cheesequake and probably Dairy Queen, okay. I'll be looking for certain traits for the garden, and hopefully we'll pick the best phenotype for that. So anyway, that's my take on fem seeds, and as far as outdoors, the propagating and making pollen and spreading throughout.
It's the a marketing population. Thing that just causes you to buy more seeds because these all.
It really is.
Something happened, and also it's just a marketing.
Now I've seen people. Now I'll tell you, and I'm more surprised. Just to be 100% disclosure, I mean, I've seen people that have bought seeds from like Fem Seeds from Dutch Passion, and they've gotten a nice phenotype, and they haven't got herms, and that fucking great. That's fucking awesome, you know. But I would say this, it still sounds like that there was selection going on.
Yeah.
Because he had to find, I found the one that was really nice. Okay, so that's selection right there. And, you know, I'm still going to say that one from natural bred seed, the best, is going to outdo the best from some fem seed.
Okay.
So you can get lucky, just like you can get unlucky and get a herm in any seed from any person, no matter how hard they try.
And usually the autoflowers are more compact.
Yeah, you know, autoflowers, we don't work with autoflowers, although people urge me to. I'm really a person who has a strong belief that my love for really good pot has led to the creation of really strong medicines. Because I don't know, this Cheesequake, I don't know if you've heard, just recently tested 23% THCA.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's off the freaking chart. They had to create a pie chart for this thing. I was like, this is insane looking, you know? I don't even know what it means yet, to be honest with you, you know? And that is a certain phenotype, obviously. But the reason that is because, you know, I've always believed the Rudellerses are the other way. You know, those were genetically strains that were low THC. And so something that necessarily I don't want to breed into anything that I'm working
with. They're like K-weed.
It's kind of
snowstone. I've seen those fields.
So there's that. So let's smoke a few more bowls. Now I'm smoking what? The Ask Afghani Clusterfuck?
Dry.
I like that
smoking
a lot.
It dry.
I liked it a lot.
It's got the classic, a little bit in the background Afghani, but it's got a lot more than, that's why we hang on to it, than any other Afghani I've ever had.
Yeah, no, I can see that.
And it's some right good stuff.
Well, I gave a little butt of it to my coffee guy. Mm-hmm. And he was so fucking high when I drove back by, he couldn't make me a coffee, so he had to get the girl to work for him to make
me
a coffee.
Can you turn my sign around the window?
So he needed a sign that said open, closed, and stoned as shit, because he was fucking out of there, man.
Make your own coffee day.
Yeah, man, he was.
Come on in.
People drive. What do you want?
He was also surprised because recently, I had those vortexes that I butted out when I was gone on vacation. Mm-hmm. And all I really wanted to know is the ones that had the shitty smell, the funky fruity smell, and not the lemon one. Right. You know, I know the lemon one won the cup, but it's not the one I'm looking for. So I really wanted to just find them out. But of course I was going to run those through the garden and, you know, harvest them and smoke them all.
Might as well, they're gone.
Man, they got so tall and out of shape, and roots came with thrips. So I got it under control. But on these six plants, you know, there was thrips all over the bottoms of them, you know, and I really couldn't spray those because they're in my bud room.
Right.
And they're in there with some seeded plants, but I still use my shuck for to make meds. Mm-hmm. So I don't really want anything sprayed in there, so I'm real careful about it. So I didn't do anything. So I'm looking at these plants that are taller than the fucking light and got all tall and spindly because I left CO2 on full and was out of town for 10 days. And that's, you know, being counterkept with him dying, but he's not a, you know, he's not a guru.
Turn the CO2 off and in flower.
Yeah. So I had other stuff going on. So, but anyway, I was able to determine, you know, the second shelf buds had developed really nice resins and they were sinking up crazy. And I was able to easily go, okay, lemon. Okay, something fucking fruity rotten thing. Okay, lemon. And I killed them. We just got rid of them. You know, I was thinking, okay, five more weeks with these tall, lanky son bitches that are in my way, much taller than anything else I have. Mm-hmm. I have fresh plants that don't have thrips because I've treated them now to go in this spot. And so a lot of people would think I'm crazy, but I just made the decision to get rid of them. But since it was about 4 weeks old, I just bagged it all up and gave it to Coffee Guy. So he's happier than a pig in shit, man. He's sorting through all this. Yeah, he's got all that speedy ass fucking white resin weed. Yeah. But it was stinking. I mean, it was stinking out of heaven. It was already producing heavy resins.
Hanging up in the windows.
Who knows, man? Who knows? I just... he was so happy, so that's kind of fun. I don't think he watches the weed during, but it's kind of fun to make somebody's day like that. So now he's got weed for, you know.
I think you mentioned something. I was out trying to fill us a freezer here a couple weeks ago, and a friend of mine had some medical condition come up.
Timmy. I tell him about Timmy. How's Timmy?
We had to get Timmy down off the hill, and he ended up with a stent about 3 or 4 hours later. And Timmy's actually doing better. I'm glad to have him around.
Okay. People will be glad to hear he's doing better, because I had talked about it.
Oh, okay. An old boy that Timmy fishes with said, "Oh my God, have you seen the Garden of Weeden?" Got his little TV phone there, and he's punching it, and he typed in Weeden. Holy shit, you can tell, look, he's got the barn right there. There's a tractor. There's an old boy fishes with him.
Okay.
And I've met him a couple of times. I've you know, puffed in his boat.
Right.
Yeah, he was all excited. Oh my God, have you seen this? Anyway, Timmy made a point of that, telling me that in elk season. So Nordberg, if you're out there, hey. A couple other people that I know from years gone past have seen it. I know that's you. It's not me. Trust me. It's not me. I mean, it's not him. I'm not him.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome. Well, so we're going to figure out a nice song to take us out on, and we'll be right off to finish off the Weed Nerd. You're watching Subcool TV, special on the road edition from Weeden. Dave. Okay, so he's going to practice on something, and I'm going to continue to smoke. So right now, I've been continuing to smoke the Afghani clusterfuck, and it's just like the last time. I don't know if it's this one or if it's the accumulation of all five that I've had, but I'm kind of high. So props to Travis the Hashmaster again. He's done an amazing job. Now, did you make this with yours, his combination?
Sort of everybody's, because I go through it, it's I'm sorting it out for people and it, you know, weighed out so that we get limits.
Well, I was going to tell you that I don't think I've ever seen
a collection that nice before and doing what I do, I know how much work it represents. I mean, it represents
hundreds of hours.
I mean,
just
yeah.
Dreaded it's just, sitting there.
Yeah, no, I can totally, and the really, I mean, to have that much, I mean, and if I'm not mistaken, you have dry, you've made bubble for most of them.
The bubble's done, yeah. You know.
So you made tincture for most of them.
Oh yeah, I'm
so good. He's made tincture, he's made bubble, he's made the keef, and of course the flowers, you're taking care of the flowers.
Yeah. A little bit of everything.
He's basically taking care of a couple of gardens, finishing out, because if you don't take care of the shit, it rots, it molds. You can't just lay it on the frickin' ground. And the one thing is, it's so overwhelming.
Yeah.
It, what you do guys do, you have so much at one time.
Yeah. But we're utilizing as much as we possibly ever could off of one plant.
Right, it's, right.
Every process is reclaiming something, whether it be tincture or, you know, our trim, or, you know, it's going to be reclaimed. Everything gets broken into so many processes that it...
Man, that's so cool. It's so neat to see it go like that. And, I mean, like I say, you outdoor growers have to go all year, you know. Indoors, we have the luxury of being able to, you know, like with harvest, I harvested two plants this weekend. And that was enough. I mean, it was like 20 hours worth of work.
We have friends that help us out once. Yeah, when we get into summer, it's like, hey man, you got anything? They're here, brought you something, you know. And in the fall, we kind of take care of them.
Right, right. It works out. Well, that was the one thing that struck me when I came here. I mean, you didn't just give me he gave me a half pound when I met him. I had to stop him. He was like grandma with food or some shit.
He won't take it either.
Yeah,
he won't take it.
This guy was just like,
so. Summer when it's dry out.
Well, yeah, he likes to smoke my weed when he's out of weed. So
he likes to smoke mine because I'll bring him the cheese back when he runs out.
And he's out.
I'm the hoarder.
You still have it.
There you go.
Right. Well, this is really, I mean, all this keef that I'm smoking is really good quality. I'm really high. I mean, I have my knee on the way over was pretty much throbbing, and now I don't know I have a knee.
Yeah, I'm
so that's kind of neat just to know that, you know. I would even say my thumb's not hurting right now.
Oh, I'm not sure which one to go with next.
This is really good. The Indy Dry Rose. This kind of scares me a little bit.
Jack the Ripper?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's
too much for you, huh?
No, it's not too much for me. It's
Don't
got,
be scared.
I'm not scared.
What's neat is seeing how different ones have the oil and resin that will pack them almost instantly solid, and like the Vortex is still a fine sugar that rolls around.
It is. But you know, the Vortex is really pure, even though it won't pack down, you know? And the other one that I thought was really pure was the, which one was I just smoking a minute ago? That's this one right here. This one's packed down really nice under the chunks.
Yeah, and those aren't, you know, pressed in there.
No, you can see it's just stuck.
Handled. That's
that so Indy Dry Rose see. You have to scrape.
Yeah, or like this train wreck.
Oh, that train wreck, yeah. I've been smoking this
one too. Flip that upside down.
I've been smoking this
All one. I can say is, don't cry, there's no place for a kitty, Ricky.
Yeah, I've been smoking that for 2 weeks, man. And I'll tell you what, we were talking about this on the phone. Three hits is just right for me. If I have
just
five,
I hit
I'll start looking her over my shoulder. And if you have like three and you take a little break and then have like three, man, you might fall the hell out on the couch. You don't want to stop moving.
Yep. Hit and go.
You hit and go.
What I did is hit and go. Just a hit an hour.
Yeah. Because it's stronger than you think. Of course, that's the TGA Blood Wreck. And what nice keef it is. And I'm not kidding. You can roll it up, make a little worm, and those guys are dabbing it up at the mist.
It's all stuck and stuff.
Unbelievable.
Liquor and hoe. I like liquor and hoe. Cigarettes and dope and mustard and bologna and liquor and hoe. I was drinking down at the Legion. Okay, that's enough there, I'm sorry. That was our entertainment place having a hit. Yeah, I can't remember all of it. Something about Bubbles tells his new wife to be, likes liquors and whores. And she catches him down at the Legion drinking, drunk on gin, dancing with his girlfriend because he likes liquor and whores.
Well, that's too much.
I should have worked on that one a little more. Love liquor and whores.
All right, we'll be right back. I'll finish up the show.
I need a young, dumb, rich, nymphomaniac. Another Jason point.
So Dave here actually wrote the TGA theme song that you guys heard the other day. So he's actually going to play it the way it was supposed to be played. instead of with the tool mix. So,
I don't know, supposed to be played. You like that, didn't you? The tool mix?
I like it. I mean, he really started getting badass toward the end. The lyrics don't quite fit. But yeah, the last minute of the song is really badass, and I really enjoy it. So I like the song, you know what I mean? But I don't think the lyrics actually fit. But yeah, I like the fact that my theme song end of it, the guy goes completely apeshit. Yeah, that's badass. Yeah,
he's quite a picker. That guy.
Okay, so TGA gear. Let's
roll. Oh shit! How does this go?
Yeah, okay. Spot.
Oh man.
Okay, this is the video camera's rolling.
Nope.
This is just content, okay? So I'm continuing to smoke here.
They don't think I'm high enough yet.
Uh-huh. There's a couple you haven't really enjoyed.
This was a gooey duck.
This is a gooey duck? I meticulously hand-mouthed a little gooey duck. If you look in that one we did down the barn down there, you can see it kind of flashes across it. It was train wreck wet, I think. Yeah, train wreck water. Anyway, it used to look like a little gooey duck in a clamshell, or called them up north pissers. And I noticed it on a video. Nobody else seen it. It's like, ah, no, I had all that pisser clam and put it in there. And, anyway, we broke pisser's head off and he threw it in his bowl here, so he's trying to smoke some gooey duck. Me, on the other hand, I'm going to have cheese here in a minute. We had a couple. I got to catch my breath. Then there's sweet stone dry and tiny bone dry.
Yeah, I'm going to have some of that.
Well, and then we got this other one to go through, too.
So. No, I don't know if I can go through the other one now.
I think he's up to 15. Yeah, 15's okay. Didn't want to go for 20. You lost your screen. It's hot. I recognize that. It's a hot screen. Didn't take him long to look at it.
Okay, now what was this again?
That was pure sour savor crossed with special gold. Our buddy, we'll call him Dry Knob Bob.
I know Dry Knob Bob.
Do you?
Yeah, fucking A, I said Dry Knob Bob something.
He's a good old boy.
I know, he's a good old
he's
boy.
He's the one you saw.
He has Frank Zappa as an avatar.
Yes.
Yes.
He, well, on a can of sights. I haven't been on a can of sight in a year. He's the one you saw.
Hi, Dry Knob Bob.
Hi, Dry Knob Bob. He's the one you signed that calendar for, and he ain't been up to get it since, because I had to move and some other stuff. He'll get his calendar, my guy. Maybe he wouldn't come up for Warren Haynes. Maybe he'll come up and I don't know, see some other band. So it's Pure Sour Savor by Special Gold.
Okay.
I have no idea. We'll hear it from his lips here in a second. Can you tell that one away from the other 17 kinds of track?
Yeah.
Oh shit.
Kind of has like a spice rum taste to it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll try and get a flower of it next time.
This would be really good pressed.
Really?
You'll see that.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's spicy.
You heard her here, Dry Knob.
It's nice. Not bad at all.
Now you're gonna go for some more cheese.
Surprise. Okay, Sweet Dry Stone. I think I might have liked this one.
It just
glue.
It packs itself in or won't come unglued. Oh, Sweet Stone?
Ooh.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Look at the color on that, Earl.
Sometimes I gotta prime my mini bubbler. It's getting, been smoking hash through it for a while. Every once in a while I go. Open her back up. I'd take a scoop of that, please.
This
not
is
a real big scoop.
Okay.
One heaping teaspoon.
Holy teaspoon. Cow and chicken nuggets. Well, this will wake me up. I can tell.
Yeah?
Thanks, hybrid. Ready?
Yeah.
Have a dang day. It's like having a cup of coffee for me.
I really.
Yeah, well done.
Between the combination of all of them,
it usually works out.
If I had a toe tag on right now, I'd say stone.
You'd still like Tiny Bone best.
Probably so. You know, hash is different though. Water hash and dry hash is so different.
Yeah.
When I'm not smoking water hash, I will acquire a taste for dry fish when that's what I have, you know? And once you acquire that taste, then you can taste it better. When I'm smoking full melt Apollo or a tiny bubble, I can't really taste anything else. I can't taste flowers.
You know, at the bottom, if you do it into a bucket with your bubble bags,
yeah.
In the bottom of those buckets, if you look, it'll go through 25 micron cloth. I used to put it through a rain fly for a tent. You know how, and you have to touch it on the bottom and get it wet and spray it so any water come through. All that clear little gray goo in the bottom, they'll run through a 25 and it's hatch. It's like the turpin and tiny little stuff. But it makes a big difference, I think.
Yeah, no, I agree.
And I used to take the time to put all that through a rain fly and end up with next to nothing. And if you didn't get to it quick enough, it turned black and ugly. But one of our patients loves it.
I cook with a lot of the smaller headed or half headed ones. Most of my strains, the 120 bag does okay. The 90 bag that I didn't own, oh my God, do I love that black bag. I mean, it just produces. But you know, again, that's not for everybody. I have a friend that does hazes. And he does a lot better than 73 and the 45, yeah. The 40, whatever it is, the 75. Well,
if they're haze or sativa, so they're always
a little bit smaller.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I don't know if we've talked about it on the show or not, the Jack's Cleaner, you know, it's so fucking crystally. If you look at it, it's so gooey. But it doesn't really produce large amounts of bubble because it has, the heads are very long and they're pretty, but they don't have a big head on top of them.
Yeah. Go so, right through.
Yeah, they go right through, you know.
Even in the dry sip, the same thing. A plant that's coated in resin won't produce hash because it can't break through. It just clogs the stream.
You know what I would like to taste? Where's the Titan's Killer Queen? Not to be picky.
Is he here?
No, he's not here.
Oh, it's hash. Okay.
I have heard from him, though, a couple times. He's doing okay. He ended up with a crazy-ass one. It almost did him in. I don't know if he's got the way.
Oh, crazy in a bad way?
Yeah. Sorry to hear that.
Although, that's...
Yeah, that's hard. Well, you know, it's part of life. Good job on the tunes.
Thank you.
You know who else I was checking out the other day that I'm not a big fan of? But there's something about video that really changes your perception on
artist.
Yeah. You know, I watched some documentary about Eddie Vedder and when he actually came to the band.
I had that same revelation.
Yeah.
That video. Yeah.
Yeah. I
didn't have an appreciation for him when he was big, and I was.
I really did. I bought the album, but
I gained a whole new appreciation after watching that video.
You know, I get it now. Yeah. I mean, I get what he had. I mean, this band had a really solid background, and they didn't have a singer. And then here came on this guy that had this really amazing new creative voice. You know.
I like what Pearl Jam did as far as. Once they got up there, they actually went against the Ticketmaster and a bunch of the companies.
I respect that a lot.
That was cool. And the, you know, having to deal with the fact that a couple of their fans died getting trampled at one of their concerts.
Yeah, it's really rough shit. Yeah.
Getting a whole new appreciation.
I really like that rockumentary.
Right.
It does change your appreciation for bands a lot of times. I've been watching this Metal Evolution, if you watch this thing. Mm-hmm. It's really cool, man. I mean, all the guys that grew up in metal all basically knew each other, because they were kind of outcasts. Even the story of Metallica is actually fairly amazing. I mean, we think of Metallica as this giant mega band, but certainly not. Yeah, certainly not. You know, playing gigs in L.A., you know, just trying to get ahead, and then all of a sudden it happened for them. So,
breakout artists like Davey Norris got bigger dues.
Yep.
I'm gonna break down try some Reckless Kelly.
Wow, you don't like that.
I really like the initial effect. I just can't taste it. I know it's out of our garden. It's not that I can't taste pot or hash, it's just that I can't taste our pot or hash. I can't smell it. I'm around it too much.
That's weird.
Let's say 10, 11 years, 12 years, I've been around it too much.
No. I haven't got that sensation yet, but in my own garden, I noticed that the smells all tend to blend together. And if I carry my own flowers away from my garden and away from my home, I'll never forget the first time I had Quercle, which I considered kind of a bland smelling weed.
I took a couple of buds with me on the road trip. Fuck, man. And it basically smells like you're smoking it even when you're not.
Yeah.
Like if you crack open a big bag of Quirkle in a hotel room, they might call you and accuse you of smoking pot even if you're not smoking pot.
The maid's checking in every 10 minutes if he dials or anything.
Dioxide actually got in, almost got in a civil lawsuit because he was on the road traveling. And he stopped at a place to get a hotel room, and he stayed in a fairly decent hotel. It wasn't some shithole. And the guy told him he had no smoking policy. Dioxide's like straight, no problem.
Use a vaporizer.
I'm not gonna smoke in the room. No, he prepared it in the room, and he went outside. You know, he's not, you know, he's not an asshole. Yeah. He's being respectful.
I'm trying to keep it concealed.
But he's smoking the fucking dank, you know.
Put a door open.
When they cleaned the room, you know, basically, I guess the housekeeping reported that he was smoking in the room. You know, and so you know the guy built him, and so Dioxide, you know, he said, "Hey, I'm not smoking in the fucking room." And the guy's like, "Yeah, you are." And he goes, "I'm not. You know, I've heard what you said, and I'm not." And it almost went to this case because they really wanted to push the issue, and he did too because fucking didn't smoke in the room. You know, when I stood in the cold, as a matter of fact. So it was just one of those funny things, huh? But so that strain, especially the Quirkle, when you take it away from my garden, it stinks. Now, on the other hand, I was shucking cheese today, the Exodus cheese. I was shucking.
Is that what it is?
I was shucking big piles of it, and we're full of seed and full of dairy queen. And it did. And I got up and walked out of that area and went and got something to drink, went to the bathroom, came back, and holy fuck, I opened the door and I was like, holy shit.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really indescribable. You know, yet we say it smells like cheese. We all know what we're talking about. That really quite doesn't cover it, does it? It smells like a hot baked cheese, apple, fruit, pie, metallic. It's got all these weird.
I've already got the munchies like crazy.
I know. But it does. Spot cheese is really a unique strain. We all call it cheese, but it's that doesn't quite cut it. And as you're growing it, wow, do you get a from week say 6, 7, and 8 as it finishes up, you get some. I mean, at week 7, early 7, it's fucking nasty.
Yeah, it smells like hot vomit or some shit. You go in there and go, ooh, you know.
The story I got on the cheese was I made the cheese for the folks at BM Grill.
Yeah.
I made cheese. Made them money.
Okay. Well, that can make sense. But it does. You can't say that it doesn't have a particularly odoriferous. Mm-hmm. I mean,
it's unique in its own. It's unique in its own. It's got a little funk in there, and I wouldn't relate it to cheese, but it could be construed as a cheese-like funk.
Yeah, it's a bacon. To me, I smell of something really frousty, baked good.
Hot apple pie.
Something really funky. You know, it's quite enough, but it's not quite right. You know, you don't know if you would eat it or not. You know, but it does make your mouth water, and Miss Jill's not a huge fan of it now because when we smoked the cheese quake, we liked it so much that it kind of took away our judge. Yeah, but it used to, when I used to break it up on the tray, she used to, it would make her salivate. Yeah, she'd be like, it just makes me hungry.
You were talking about the hotel room and stuff and dioxide getting in trouble, getting out of it, of course. I remember a few years ago, were you there? No, I think he was there maybe. We walked into, and this is a big ass motel, like with the big east wing that goes out and the big, you know, lobby and courtyard thing. Walked in and it was stifling to walk in because like, oh my God, somebody's stash caught on fire or something down the hallway. And it looked like walking through fog all the way down there. Of course, I know whose rooms it was coming out of, the whole wing, all the disabled rooms were all card holders and everything up. And the guy at the front desk was flipping a fit. Oh my God, they're smoking the marijuana in there, and we're all gonna chase and rape sheep and rob liquor stores. And it's like, well, they're not smoking, go down, that's vapor. It's like, what? I said, they're vaporizing, they're not smoking. Well, they weren't, they were hitting the vaporizer, big bags and stuff like we used to use. Like, oh God. And it was, you could hardly see through it on the way down the hallway. That was funnier than hell. Then they opened up the doors where it's at, it's always, it's a real sought after windboarding or wind sailing spot.
Okay.
It cleared out fairly quick, but
oh my god, yeah,
the guy was freaking out.
So we went to one time we went up to the Governor Hotel, and I saw it the other day with all the politicians there, but somehow Norma would talk them into taking one of the rooms on the inside of the
next quarter.
No, it was inside somewhere. Oh. It was an indoor room, and they had some 5-gallon buckets sitting on the tables with sand, and man, every fucking hippie I know was in that room. I mean, no shit. And they were all getting high, so that was, we gave out a bunch of seeds, and we took about, I don't know, we had about a half pound or something, we proceeded to get everybody as high as we possibly could. And I'll never forget, man, that, because it's like a somewhat of a Portland landmark or whatever. And we smoked that bitch down, man. I mean, and they let us. I mean, it was just like, it's like this designated room was for medicating and
coughing and hacking.
Good thing my dab boys wasn't in there house yet, you know.
Me and St. John and Happy Hunter, Danibus, John King was drumming, we had a bass player, a couple backup singers, conga player. What was that thing, 8,000 square feet, big log building, a little Cedar Park place, and we couldn't see from the stage. I literally couldn't see. All you could see is kind of white, and you could see little stuff moving around out there. People are up taking pictures. The pictures are, you can see little white dot or little dots kind of in the white, like ghosts up in the background and stuff. Oh, I miss those days.
All right, so that's it for the special content section. We're actually going to go out this time, so thanks again for everything.
Thanks, sir.
Hanging out.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate it, brother. Thanks. Talk to you guys later. Yeah, have a day.